Good morning. I call this meeting of the Lord Selkirk West Caledonian Community Committee to order. It's September 8th, 2021, and I acknowledge that we are meeting here on Treaty One land and the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation. I'm Councillor Debbie Sharma, representing the Old Caledonian Ward, and I'll be the chairperson for today's session. We have at the meeting Councillor Ross Eady, and participating remotely is Councillor Vivian Santos. We have members of the administration, our city clerk's team, Mr. Peter Prinsloo, and from our administration, we have Mr. Rack here, and Mr. Daniel, and the last name?
Trenchard.
Trenchard, yes, gonna remember that one. Thank you.
We also have Kathy Gagnon.
Kathy, welcome. Okay, do we have minutes from the last meeting?
I will move the meetings of July the, what was that? Or was it late June?
June 22nd.
June 22nd, sorry.
And July 20th.
And July 20th, yes.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, that's carried.
Right, that was the special.
We'll now get into delegations. Mr. Clerk, we have Inspector Lutz.
We do. Good morning, Inspector. You're now live with the committee. You have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone, and hopefully everybody had a nice summer. And despite us still battling with COVID, we had a relatively a quieter summer overall. However, the last few weeks have picked up a little bit. So our data, I guess, from January 1st to September 8th. Is as follows. We've had 43,900 calls for service in Division 13. Our community support unit has taken 4,028 of those. And so far this year, we've made 2,059 arrests and 1,060 warrant arrests. Currently, we have 10 bulletined hotspots, including still 3 traffic hotspots in the North Main area for racing, the Addison and Jefferson area in the parking lots and residential streets, and Brookside Boulevard also for street racing. And the 7 remaining hotspots are with respect to crime and disorder type issues. And we've spent a bunch of proactive time in the division. Our spy comm hours are just shy of 70 hours. We have 325 hours of spy hotspots, 223 hours of spy subjects, 50 hours of community engagements, 28 hours of subject stops. We've had 438 hours of SPATs, which are special attentions. We've done 220 hours of beat work. We've had 1,421 traffic stops, which amounts to 342 hours, and 116 traffic events, which amounts to another 150 hours. So our total proactive time has been 1,257 hours. So far this year, the division has issued 3,915 provincial offense notices for various offenses. In terms of crime trends over the last month, we have seen a slight incline in incidents, and those are across the board: arsons, break-and-enters, homicides, robberies, sexual assaults, thefts from motor vehicles, stolen vehicles, shootings, mischiefs, thefts, and other assaults. But specifically, we have had an increase in those types of theft from motor vehicle events, mischief-related events, and things of that nature, which is kind of common with the nice weather and the kids being on summer break. Often those are done by youths who are just out in the middle of the night doing crimes of opportunity. So that's where we're standing right now. Everybody's kind of getting back from summer holidays and that sort of thing. So we're getting back into the swing of things. and certainly open to any questions now.
Thank you, Inspector. Counselor Eby?
Yeah, I have a couple of.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Inspector Lutz, and thanks for welcoming him. It's like we're back in school, right? So, all right.
Yeah.
How far south does the North Main traffic speeding hotspot, how far south does that go?
I think we're going up to Inkster. Like the bulk of our sort of issues that we've that have been brought to our attention are north of Inkster. That's where we've been focusing.
Yeah, because I'm getting a number of residents who live kind of around the McDonald's, around Kingsbury Main Street, yeah. and the apartments. Actually, I'm getting complaints from the some of the apartments near the Burger King, like Enniskill and Rupert's Land, sort of across the street from the Briar. Although I don't think the Briar is the source of the problem. The problem is they're racing and they're very loud cars, right? So
I can
even hear them on Scotia at if I'm outside on the front stoop at like 1:30, 2 in the morning, like Sunday, Saturdays, I can hear them speeding. They're very loud cars. So
And I'll be honest, it's pretty common across the city where people are just out with less to do now with a lot of the COVID restrictions still. And they, you know, they're just cruising around in the middle of the night in these souped up cars and motorcycles and whatnot. So we've been dealing with a lot of those types of complaints. And, you know, the issue to a certain degree is that the problem is always moving, right? So it's hard to just track it right down to the source, because when we get there, they're gone. But we're working on that. It is a problem, like I said, across the city, and we've been trying to clamp down on it as best as we can.
What were the property crime stats? Like on social media and hearing from neighbors and even myself, have there been a lot of reports of property theft and breaking into garages, that kind of stuff?
Yeah, so I wanted those stats today, but as luck has it, our computer program, which pumps those out, wasn't available yet yesterday and this morning. So I'm speaking anecdotally, just that they have kind of gone up a bit, is my understanding, talking to some of our members, where some of the garage shed break-ins, you know, just these little, I guess, crimes of opportunities and thefts have kind of gone up a little bit. And as I spoke to earlier, a lot of times in the summer holidays, the kids are just out, you know, walking around in the middle of the night and, you know, either putting each other up to this sort of thing, or it's try a vehicle door and see if it's open and rifle through it, not kind of, you know, mischief-y theft type occurrences. But I don't, unfortunately, have those specific numbers today to share with you.
Okay. The final question I have is, I know the police service has attended this area quite a bit, but like this summer and like along Main Street from the underpass north to basically say Mountain Avenue, but mostly further south, there's a lot of like business customers are being harassed. I'm hearing from the North End Biz, I'm hearing about altercations between people working for businesses and people sort of just out on the street doing drugs and that kind of thing. Of that patrolling, how much has really happened? Is most of it in that area?
Yeah, so we've spent a lot of time on there because of I've gotten those complaints and concerns. And that's been going on, wow, since probably, you know, we had that early summer where it got really warm, even in end of April into May. And yeah, we've had those problems and they've been ongoing, and we put a lot of time onto patrolling, you know, Main Street from the underpass, you know, all the way up, you know, to basically Redwood there. But it's just continuing to be a problem. You know, we're going to have a different look at it to see if we can, if there's something else we can do, because I know it continues to be a bit of an issue.
I'm just really worried it's going to start getting really more people fighting back, right?
Yeah, and I agree with you. And yeah,
I have one business that's been established right around Euclid and Stellar around there. I mean, they've been there almost 100 years, and the guy called me and he says, I just can't stay here anymore.
Yeah.
I go, my customers won't come here anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We had an issue with, it was a, I guess it's a bit of a rehab facility where there was a walk-in component to it there, and they've switched their mandate, I guess, so it's not so much a walk-in established anymore. So that may help, because that was a bit of a problem for a long time.
Yeah, I'm hoping that just happened. Like a week or so ago.
Yeah, a week ago. Yeah, I was gonna say, yeah, it was about a week away. So
we'll see what happens. But anyway, yeah. I'm glad you're paying attention to it. Thank you.
Yeah, we're trying our best.
Thank you, Inspector, for your time. We do appreciate you coming to Community Committee on a regular basis. There's no other questions today. Thank you.
Okay, certainly. Thank you. Hope everybody had a great summer, and I will talk to you soon. And as always, if there are any concerns, feel free to send me an email or phone.
We know where to find you. Thank you.
Okay. Take care.
Mr. Clerk, next delegation.
Our next delegation is Nat Sran, President Sranco, to be heard with respect to plan approval, Garfield Avenue, which is report 2 on our agenda today. Good morning, Nav. You have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation, starting now.
Good morning, councillors, planners, and fellow citizens in attendance today. My name is Navdeep Singh Sran. It's my pleasure to be here with you all through Zoom call.
Are you on? No.
No, Mr. Sran is joining us via telephone.
Okay, you're via telephone. Okay, Mr. Sran.
Via Zoom call.
You can in the future have a video conference with us as well, if you choose in the future, but we see that you're via telephone today. Go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. So today I'm representing my dad, Jasmil Singh Sran, and myself as the developers of this property. I'd like to begin with thanking you very much for giving us this opportunity to speak to you and to tell you more about us and our project in Waterford Green. So we've been active builders in Winnipeg, specifically the Waterford Green area, since 2015, and have constructed and sold 46 side-by-side units and built several single-family homes as well. And our past settlements have been very well received. They're quick to sell, demonstrating not only the high quality of the structures, but also the demand for these units in this community. The Waterford's Women's Commercial Center, which houses the statue of the recently inaugurated Dr. Jose Rizal, was also co-developed by us. And although we are from Surrey, British Columbia, we spend a lot of our time focusing our family business there in Winnipeg, and have been grateful to have had the opportunity to play a part in creating the atmosphere in Waterford Green. Our project vision for this subject property aligns with past projects. So we intend on creating units in a tasteful way that complements the safety and highlights the personality of the community. And we want residents of this community to share a backdrop that's inviting, helps produce good memories, and allows families to thrive. So a little bit about this property. It's located in the northeastern quadrant of Winnipeg and in Waterford Green. So this neighborhood houses over 3,000 families and situated across from Waterford Commons Commercial Center. There's a 4.45 acre plot of land is undeveloped and beaming with potential. It's at the intersection of Garten Ave and Old Commonwealth Path, and this parcel has the potential to be developed to a more desirable, livable space than what is currently the state of this parcel. Bearing in mind the current aesthetic of the homes in the area, we're confident that we can help build homes that complement the neighborhood, all while satisfying the growing demand for new home ownership. We understand the importance of planning communities such that they remain desirable well into the future. And you can see in our plans that we have taken this responsibility seriously. So our project, the plan envisions 88 Bearland condos, inviting into it approximately 176 new occupants. And the typical units are approximately 1,900 square feet each, including attached garage. Each typical unit will have a total of 3 parking spots, 1 in the single car garage and 2 in the driveway, with the exception of a few units, which will have a total of 2 parking spots. In addition, we've included visible interconnected walkways around the developments. This helps create a pedestrian-friendly environment and also a good sense of community. So we've had a great presence in this community for over 5 years and have over 25 years doing construction and development. And we strongly feel that our past reputation developments demonstrate an eagerness to improve the community. So with all of this being said, I'd like to thank you very much again for your time this morning. And we look forward to continuing to be a part of the future in Winnipeg. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your time. Mr. Saran, any questions at this point? Just one question, I'll start. Mr. Saran, you worked collaboratively with our planner, with our Mr. Rackhair, and there were some changes along the way that needed to be made to get to the point where we're here today. Can you go over some of those changes and the collaborative manner you worked with him?
So obviously, firstly, I'd like to thank Rack. He's been great to deal with, as well as Mike from Zoning. And just one of the changes of how collaborative efforts we can achieve better results was, like on the south side, Rack suggested, since we are a little bit close to those houses in the on Marianne Way, to decrease the building height. That was one. As well as just feedback on how the units that face Old Commonwealth Path and Garten Ave and how they should be more aesthetically pleasing. So we went back and we added materials and made designs that you know that could be taken as aesthetically pleasing, and just throughout the whole process. There's been a lot of back and forth with Mike and Rack as well, and they've been of great help, and we really enjoyed working with them, and we look forward to working with them in the future.
Okay, thank you. Any further questions at this point? Okay, seeing none, we appreciate you taking the time to present to the committee today.
Thank you very much.
Have a great day. Thank you.
You too.
Mr. Clerk, that concludes our delegations.
That's correct.
Okay. Moving on to report one is a request for new street names to be added to the Lord Selkirk West Kildonan Community Committee street names reserve list. Is this why we have a member of the administration here?
Yes, there's a number of matters here for which the
but this particular one, Ms. Gagnon is here for that.
I believe Kathy is here for our first public hearing
item. Okay, for the public hearing item. Yeah. Okay, great. Well, my intention with this one committee is I'd like to lay it over just to spend a little bit more time looking at the street names and possibly adding some other ones to the list, if that's okay. Councillor Reedy, would you move layover to the next meeting on my behalf?
Yes, and I just wanted to make a comment before I move that is there's a lot of names here. I don't know that this development's that big. I guess they're going to use all those. But anyway, I move that to the next meeting.
Yes.
I move that we lay this street names list report to our October the
next meeting in October?
Yeah, our October meeting.
Okay, thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. And this is, you're right, Councillor Edie, the first phases of the development isn't huge, but overall, it's a big development. So you're just looking into the future.
Okay.
Thank you. Next item is item two, plan approval for Garten Avenue. We just heard the delegation on this one. We can maybe get a presentation from our planner.
Yes, of course. This application is plan approval for a site in Waterford Green. The site is located at the southwest corner of Old Commonwealth Path and Garten Avenue. The proposal is a bareland condo style of development in total 88 units. The units would be in a mix of buildings with two units per building. Some would have three units per building. Some buildings would be a single unit. Access to the development site would be from Garten Avenue into a private roadway. The roadway would be part of the condo development. Each unit would have an attached garage on the main level, and the residential living areas would be on the second and third level. As well as prior to this application, they did go through a collaborative planning process with the administration. A number of items that we asked them to consider and change were mainly focused around assuring that the site was walkable, accessible, and that there was a sufficient amount of parking that could be provided without impeding the walkability and accessibility. So we asked for the driveways to be wide enough and long enough to appropriately park vehicles without blocking the path of travel. We asked for a circular walking path through the center of the development. And we asked them to orient the building so that the buildings that were along the public streets were facing the public streets instead of backing onto them. So the main doors would face the public streets and the garages and parking would be behind the buildings. And they've complied with all of our suggestions. And as the delegation mentioned, we also asked them to drop the height of some certain buildings that would be backing onto single family homes. The height of the buildings as proposed would be roughly 32 feet. Some of the buildings closer to Old Commonwealth Path would be roughly 33 feet. Visitor parking is also being provided. There's three visitor parking areas sort of divided into the spread out amongst the development. And the vehicle access would only be from one point on Garten. So there wouldn't be additional points of access. There would just be one in, one out, and then a walking path in the center of the development site. We are supportive and we recommend approval of the application.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Herr. Any questions or comments? Yeah, I just wanted to say I saw Councillor Santos nodding and, you know, appreciate the collaborative manner that the applicant worked with you and the changes that were made. And those are things that you've identified, but also things this committee has talked about over time about using particular materials and accessibility. So I thank you for underscoring those types of things when you're working with the various developers. Any further questions or comments? Okay. Seeing none, Councillor Santos, do you wish to move approval?
Thanks. All the comments that were made, I completely agree with. Thanks, Rack. You do a wonderful job working with developers and ensuring that all the concerns have been heard. And I don't have any other questions or comments, so I'm very happy to move this plan approval for Garten Avenue and support the Winnipeg Public Services recommendation.
Thank you, Councillor Santos. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Next item is item three, development agreement amendment, DASZ 30 of 2013. This I had an opportunity to meet the applicant and the landscape architect on site recently, and my intention is to lay this over. I had some outstanding questions about communicating to the residents prior to any work that's done, and I also had some questions for the administration, and they're going to get back to me on a few items. So I would like to
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Just help me out, like, it doesn't help me. I'm not understanding where, which development is.
Okay, you know what? Good point. If we can get a bit of a high-level summary first from yourself, Mr. Trenchard, and then I'll go into.
Sure. So the development agreement in question is AG 30 of 13, which is the Castleberry Meadows development, north of Commercial Avenue, east of King Edward. So in 2013, the developer entered into an agreement with the city, which had a requirement to build a stormwater retention basin, which was your standard sort of old style, I'll say, with the stone revetment around the perimeter of the pond and sodded slopes up from there. In the time since it was constructed, I believe they achieved construction completion in 2015, but they've never been able to have the pond approved by the city inspectors because the sod surrounding the pond has been trampled and eaten by the geese such that it doesn't meet the standard for acceptance. So the developer's been working with administration for some time to come up with a solution, and this summer engaged with a consultant who came up with a proposal to naturalize the public component of the stormwater retention basin with sort of the wetland plants at the water level and then some natural grasses up the slope. And their opinion was that this would assist with goose abatement and just sort of have the nesting birds not focusing on the pond so much, which would allow the area to be approved by the city inspectors at an acceptable standard within the constraints of our requirements. So, and that's what the recommendations. There is one more part to it, in that the developers requested a non-standard warranty period. The standard naturalized retention pond warranty period is 5 years, since the plantings are done in three stages. So it results in a 2-year warranty from the last stage of plantings. They've requested just a 3-year warranty so that when the last planting goes in, the pond itself comes off warranty. And the administrative recommendation on that was not to approve the request and to stick with the standard 5-year warranty. Yeah.
Thank you. So we heard that summary. Yes, absolutely.
This is a concern. You'll remember this, Madam Chairperson. I'm noting in here a change, and it says piped outlet. Does that mean there's like a culvert? And I remember in old Kildonan, around 20 odd years ago, mm-hmm. where a child drowned, where there was a culvert kind of outlet of land drainage.
So the piped outlet is it like it's not a standard at water level outlet. It would be under the water level. I think around 2.2-ish meters mm-hmm. below the water level is the standard. And it's not, it doesn't get the sort of siphoning effect that you would see with a surface culvert that you're referring to. It's just sort of a gravity as the water level goes up, it slowly goes over a baffle wall and then will drain back into the system. And ultimately, like the system of lakes the city has is from one pond to another, and then ultimately goes into a lake or river somewhere. So I believe this pond drains into the Garten Pond further east and then works its way through the maples to the Red River eventually.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, excellent. That's a good question though. So the city standard now is naturalizing all ponds. This was done prior to that standard. And now the developer at their cost wants to naturalize the pond.
That's correct.
To mitigate some of the problems we're having with geese.
So I'll move to lay this over.
Yes, if you could move, Councillor Reedy, on my behalf, that the matter be laid over for up to 60 days.
Yeah.
So we can have a chance to do some communications with the residents.
Yep. Okay. I'll move up to 60 days.
Lay over.
For the report to come back for approval.
Okay. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. We can now take a short recess and we'll reconvene at 10:30 to get into our public hearing portion of the meeting. Thank you. Good morning. I'd like to call our meeting to order. It's September 8th, 2021. It's the Lord Selkirk West Kildonan Community Committee meeting, and it's the public hearing portion. I'd like to acknowledge that we're on meeting on Treaty One land and the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation. I'm Councillor Debbie Sharma. I'll be serving as the chairperson of today's meeting. Also here is Councillor Ross Eby. Participating remotely is Councillor Vivian Santos. We have members of the administration, Mr. Rack Hare from the Urban Planning Division, Mr. Daniel Trenchard from the Land Development Branch, and remotely joining us is Ms. Kathy Gagnon from the Geomatics Branch at the City of Winnipeg. We also have our city clerk's team, Mr. Peter Prinsloo and Ms. Rebecca Ford. Mr. Clerk, over to you.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, the process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. For a more in-depth overview of the public hearing process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing, please consult the public hearing process brochure, which is available on the City Clerk's Department website. Please note that all public hearings are recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the hearings have concluded, please contact the City Clerk's Department. Item one is a closing at part of Ross Avenue, east of McPhillip Street, south of Pacific Avenue, under file DAC2/2021. All participants have been muted and will only be permitted to speak when called upon. Once you have been heard, you can either remain in the Zoom meeting or leave and continue to watch live via the city's YouTube channel. If any participants are currently watching the live meeting on YouTube, please mute your audio player now. And at this point, I'll pass it over to our planner to give an overview of the matter.
Thank you. And that would be?
Mr. Hare.
Mr. Hare, item one?
No, that would be Kathy.
Right, I thought it was Kathy. Ms. Gagnon, yes?
Kathy, if you want to go ahead and give us an overview of the matter, please go ahead.
Good morning, councillors and Mr. Clerk. This is a very straightforward application. There's a small portion of Ross Avenue east of McPhillip Street that is legally opened but has served no public transportation purpose for quite some time. It's used mostly as a parking lot for the properties to the north and south. The property, the applicant to close the property is to the north and wants to use it to basically improve it aesthetically. And has agreed with the property owner to the south to provide a couple of parking spaces so everybody's happy in that respect. The property to the south has no concerns and no interest in a purchase of any portion. So there were considerations as to what will be required on the part of the applicant to consolidate that land if it is closed with the adjoining property to the north, and to ensure that there is spatial separation considerations under the Manitoba Building Code, that they will have to have basically a no-build zone within that closing area once it's consolidated.
Thank you. Mr. Clerk, we do have questions for committee. When is an appropriate time to ask the administration?
Technically, the committee can ask questions now of the public service if you so desire, or you can save it until the presentation.
I think we'll ask the question now. Councillor Eby?
Yeah, I just it might be questions after. I just want a clarification. The property use on the north and on the south sides, do those properties go to the right of way on McPhillips, and what is the use of both those properties?
The applicant on the north, I believe they're both manufacturing. As far as zoning, the applicant was, excuse me, I have to look at that. Manitoba Building Trades. And on the south, it's a little business that I honestly did not determine after getting their consent that they had, or their confirmation that they had no objections and no interest in purchase. I wasn't, I didn't make any further inquiries as to what kind of business they operate at out of that property.
That's okay. Manitoba Building Trades, that's their new facility. Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. Any further questions? And we'll certainly have an opportunity later as well. Mr. Clerk, on to the applicant.
Yes, first we have our applicant, Mr. Sudhir Sandhu. Mr. Sandhu, you have up to 10 minutes for your presentation beginning now. Thank you.
Good morning. Sorry, just trying to unmute and first of all, councillors, good morning. It's always a pleasure to see you. Appreciate the city administration report. Some of you were in attendance a couple of weeks ago when Manitoba Building Trades officially inaugurated our new facility, which is the conclusion at this point of phase one of 15, actually in total, what will end up being a $20 million investment in this neighborhood in the city of Winnipeg. I think those of you who were able to join us on our grand opening event saw the impact that we've already had on the neighborhood, you know, with the community gardens in full bloom and students starting to come in and out of the building. Visually, it is an impact along McPhillip Street, and we know that our efforts to help revitalize this neighborhood and also not only aesthetically, but practically add a new liveliness to the neighborhood has been both a pleasure for us. We're happy to contribute to our city in making that contribution, but also in terms of the services we provide both to our union membership, which members some numbers over 10,000 in Manitoba, but also working with various school divisions in Manitoba who will be sending their students to our facility for training in various trades programs. So we're very much so engaged with our neighborhood and, you know, the conditions that administration has identified as being applicable to our application to purchase Ross Avenue. None of them are of any objection to us. We appreciate where the administration is coming from and what priorities it has in concluding this transaction and this purchase. I do want to add one thing, that expediency and timeliness is an issue for us. Unfortunately, given the history of this building and also the fact that this piece of Ross Avenue is a little bit of a forgotten piece of real estate for the city of Winnipeg. You know, to our knowledge, for the past few years, it neither has been maintained nor, for example, snow clearing, street cleaning services. Those have not been extended by the city, and we don't object to any of that. We've taken over that gladly. But there is a risk. So when administration proceeds, we would ask that we conclude this as expeditiously as possible, because the grade outside on the south side of our building is inverted. And in heavy rainfall situations, we do end up with a significant risk of water coming into our building. As of the end of this month, we will be a satellite location for the Manitoba Museum, which will be the long-term home of the 1919 strike exhibit. And that area potentially could be impacted by, at least at the ground level, by water coming into our building. So we're anxious to do this, not only because we want to upgrade that piece of Ross Avenue once we do have access to it and right over it, to bring it up to standards and re-asphalt and regrade it to make sure that it is more of a, you know, it's a better maintained piece of land, but also functional, and most importantly, mitigate the risk that we face on a daily basis if we do have any more heavy rainfall, that we could potentially be at risk. So again, don't want to belabor the point. We are very happy to participate in and contribute to revitalizing this this part of the neighborhood. It is already making a difference. I know councillors, two of you were here. If you would like to drop by for a visit again, just to take a look. And Councillor Edie, I know we've missed having you by, and we can definitely have you come by and give you an explanation and description of all the services and activities and projects that are underway here. So I will stop there, and I would happily answer any questions or questions that councillors may have on our application.
Thank you, Councillor Reedy.
Just one question. So the 1919 exhibit, are we talking about the one that's in front of the Pantages Playhouse Theater?
No. This was the inside exhibit that was a temporary exhibit in the 100th year anniversary year that Manitoba Museum had installed inside the museum. It was being, you know, after the passage of the commemorative year, these things typically get boxed up. And we discussed with the museum that the space that it's going into is actually named, it's called the 1919 Centennial Atrium. So it was a perfect fit, and it gives, public life to an important historical exhibit. Rather than it being boxed up, it'll have visibility and also give the general population in Winnipeg and Manitoba, and quite frankly, across the country, to, you know, they're welcome to come see it during business hours at any time. So it's just an added element to the building.
Cool. Anyway, thanks. That's great. Right on.
Thank you, Mr. Sander. Great to see you here today. Just a question. You read the report and there's some conditions. You're good with the report as presented?
We are good with the report as presented. The only ask is that if we could move as expeditiously, like I said, the risk that we identified is a material risk. It's a real risk. So we'd rather not get flooded. And the sooner we can get to fixing Ross Avenue, we're happy to spend our private dollars to do so.
Okay. Thank you. Councillor Reedy?
You asked the administration this, I believe this, after we vote here, it goes to P&D. I'm not sure, but
It's going to P&D, yes, and then
when
council.
I've seen these things happen with some property in my ward related to people wanting to take over that property. You are aware that our legal services, I don't know how expeditiously your expectations are, but there's a whole bunch of, aside from this vote here and getting this done by a vote by council, then there's the whole rigmarole about the agreements and stuff you have to sign and that. So what's your concept of expeditiously?
So we understand that there is a legitimate process to be undergone, and we're happy to accommodate that. But just to the extent that both parties can avoid undue delays, that's about as expeditiously as we can expect. So the sooner the better. And we will certainly do everything on our part to keep things moving. And I know the administration has been very good. I know it is a process. It's a public process. You're a public entity, so you have to be respectful of process and due process. And we will accommodate all of that, of course. So our expectation is not the next 6 weeks. We understand this is going to take time. But just as long as we can keep things moving at a steady pace and get through the process that we need to, we'd be happy with that.
Yeah. Well, this, anyway, I'll just leave it at the public process is not really going to delay you. It's when you get down to signing agreements and so on that it takes, taking a fair amount of time.
I have my pen ready, Councillor.
Okay. Any further questions at this point? Seeing none, let's move on to
those
in support, Mr. Kirk.
We have one person in support, Mr. Wayne Bowman. Good morning, Wayne. You have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation, starting now. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning. My name is Wayne Bowman. I'm a real estate consultant on behalf of the Manitoba Building Trades, and have been involved with this process right from the acquisition of the property back in early 2019. Just to give you some historical perspective, that this building was built in the early 1960s and was really in a very substandard condition. So what we did when we went through the process, and Manitoba Building Trades insisted on having nothing but the finest, most up-to-date practices within the building, a great deal of effort and money was spent on improving the building. But then as we looked on the outside, and there was Ross Avenue. So I undertook to first of all, contact CP Rail that has the property to the east of Ross Avenue there, and have secured a long-term agreement with CP Rail to utilize surplus lands that run perpendicular to McPhillips. So that, in conjunction with the Ross Avenue, will provide ample parking and so forth. But also, it's important to note, while Ross Avenue is an open and what would be regarded as an improved right of way, it's marginally improved. Railway tracks had been removed from that that right of way, and right now it's nothing but gravel and potholes. For an investment that is well in excess of $10 million that the Manitoba Building Trades have put into that property, to have that as their main entrance, you know, it's and the conditions that Sadir has mentioned about the water infiltration into the potential water infiltration into the building necessitates the gaining control of this and improving the site. Sadir has of course mentioned the importance of this development to the neighborhood and industry wide. I think that it's important to get this this improvement, this right of way acquired, and also to let you know, the occupant to the south is Mays Auto Body, and we've been in contact with them a number of times. They've given us a letter of support, as the administration has outlined. And they are currently cleaning up their particular site. But nonetheless, we have full support of the adjoining property owner. In any event, of course, we're very much in support of this and very much appreciate the help of the administration in this matter, and look forward to a positive result.
Thank you, Mr. Bowman. Appreciate you mentioning the adjoining property owner's support. I know it's listed in the report, but thank you for putting it on the public record here today. Are there any other questions? Okay, seeing none, thank you for your presentation. Mr. Clerk, is there anyone else in support?
I don't have anybody else in support or for opposition or information.
Okay. So we'll now see if there's any questions for the public service. Any further questions, councillors? Okay, and we'll call Mr. Sandhu back.
Mr. Sandhu, you now have the opportunity to speak in rebuttal to anything that has been said up to this point.
Just no new information can be shared at this point.
No, thank you, councillor, for the invitation to add further. I do not have any other information, just to reiterate that, the neighboring property, the only adjoining property, has been very supportive of the application as well. And that's all. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Councillor Eady?
This is not new information. I just have a question for the clerk. Mr. Clerk, no opposition. Is this going to go to priority directly to EPC once?
Because this is not under the development procedures bylaw, a public hearing of this sort isn't eligible for the priority rezoning process. So it goes to the SPC on PDHDD.
Okay. Is there any there's a scheduled PDHDD meeting next week. Is there any possibility that this would get to that committee?
Yes, I will do everything that I can to get it to that meeting.
Is it scheduled, Mr. Clerk, to get on that agenda?
Yeah, it was posted the agenda for PDHDD.
I will work with my colleagues to
Excellent. See if we can. Thank you. Seeing no further questions, an opportunity to put motions forward.
Yeah, sure. I'd be happy to do that, Madam Chair. Just going to the clerk, I don't see any motion to close the public hearing or anything like that. It's not like that, right? I just go straight to page three and just move the recommendation.
That's correct.
Okay. So I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and forwarded to the Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development, Heritage and Downtown Development.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Mr. Clerk?
Please note that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council. Item two is a subdivision and rezoning at land located on north and south side of Commercial Avenue, west of Hazelton Drive, under file DASZ 15 of 2021. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, this is a combined hearing and the following item will also be heard at the same time, namely, item three is a variance at land located on north and south side of Commercial Avenue, west of Hazelton Drive, under file DAV 139943/2021D. Please note, additional communications were received in support of the matter after the agenda was published, which has been distributed to all members of the committee. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application, those registered in opposition, and those registered for information. The applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. All participants have been muted and will only be permitted to speak when called upon. Once you have been heard, you can either remain in the Zoom meeting or leave and continue to watch live via the city's YouTube channel. If any participants are currently watching the live meeting on YouTube, please mute your audio player now. And once again, I'd like to pass it over to our planner for an overview.
Thank you, Peter. So this is an application for subdivision and rezoning as well as variances for land that is located on both the north and south sides of Commercial Avenue. In order to separate the title for these two pieces of property, the subdivision is required. The land on the north side of Commercial Avenue is in the Castlebury Meadows neighborhood in Precinct T. It is proposed to be rezoned to multifamily medium. The land that's on the south side of Commercial Avenue, it actually falls in the employment land / general manufacturing policy area of our Winnipeg. No change to the zoning is proposed for the land south of Commercial Avenue. It'll remain zoned agricultural. So as I mentioned, the proposal is to rezone the land to the north to multifamily medium. As mentioned, it falls within the Precinct T plan. The Precinct T plan designates that site under the higher density residential policy areas. The key policies that would apply include locating higher density residential uses on property that is abutting industrial areas, which this property does. To the west of this property is an M2 piece of land that's currently undeveloped. We're recommending approval of the rezoning subject to some conditions. Plan approval through the Lord Selkirk West Kelowna Community Committee and the Director of Planning Property Development. That'll be required to review the final design details of the proposed multifamily development. Plans have been submitted with this application. They do show 148 units in apartment style buildings, four stories in height. There is a minor variance required to accommodate the proposed buildings on the north side of Commercial Avenue. I'll explain that variance in just a moment. But one of the conditions of approval, because this land abuts manufacturing lands, we're recommending a minimum setback distance of 25 feet from the west lot line. That's to ensure that the residential dwellings or the habitable rooms are far from the industrial lands. As a result of that, it does push the development further to the east, and as a result there's a variance for the distance between parking spaces and windows to habitable rooms. The bylaw requires there to be a 10-foot separation between parking and windows when that window is 5 feet or less from grade. In this case they're proposing less than 10 feet, so a variance is required. We're supportive of that variance as we understand that the building is being pushed over to accommodate that greater setback in the west interior side yard. Also in the west side yard, we're recommending additional plantings as well as fencing. And again, this is to mitigate and buffer this site where it would interface with the industrial lands. Those details of the fencing, landscaping, as well as the final building design, all of that would be reviewed under plan approval, which again, as mentioned, would come to this community committee for final approval. For the land on the south side of Commercial Avenue, as mentioned, it would remain zoned agricultural. As a result of the subdivision, the land on the south side does become a lot of record. And in order to prevent premature development, we're recommending a condition of approval that would prohibit any permits being issued for construction of buildings or establishment of land uses on that land on the south side of Commercial Avenue. Again, that's just to simply to prevent premature development. Our expectation is that that land will be rezoned in the future to an appropriate zone. And that's the condition of approval that applies to the land on the south side. With that, we're recommending approval. It is, as I mentioned, consistent with the precinct T policies. There is a servicing agreement. My colleague Daniel Trenchard is here to answer any questions about the servicing agreement, and we're supportive of the application.
Thank you. Mr. Clerk.
First up, we have our applicant, Susan Russell. I assume she is with Melissa Nearing in the office. So in case Susan is there, you have up to 10 minutes to start your presentation.
Hello there. Can you hear us?
Yes.
Okay. You can't see us though. It's myself and Melissa. We're both here. So if it's okay with the committee, Melissa will be making the presentation and I will be interjecting as needed, and I'm available here to answer any questions that the committee may have. So I will turn it over to, and thank you very much for the committee, and thank you so much to the administration for all your help as we move through this process.
Yes, thank you for meeting with us today. As Rack had gone through all of the proposed subdivision and rezoning and proposed variances, we're just here to further answer any questions about the application and to just provide a bit of an overview of what we are proposing. Okay, so just as a bit of context, we have shown the current zoning for the area. So the proposed sites, we're saying proposed lot one will be rezoned from agricultural to RMFM, and proposed lot two would be agricultural to remain. And then just for context, we've shown that the lots to the north are existing RMFM, the lots to the east are existing R2, and then just further east, we have R1. And then to the west, we have M2. And then this is just an overlay of the land use from the Precinct T transportation policy map, just to show that, again, our proposed lot one is designated as high density residential, and same to the lot to the north. And then on the east, there's a mix of medium density residential and low density residential. So the proposed development, as was mentioned earlier, is three multifamily apartment style buildings with a total of 148 units, with a total height of 4 stories or 45 feet, and at grade surface parking to meet the bylaw requirement of 1.5 stalls per unit, which would be 228 stalls. And then all landscaping is to meet bylaw requirements. So within the proposed development, we're just highlighting the pedestrian path of travel in yellow here around the buildings. And then in red, we're showing a proposed connection to the pond on the west side of the development, as well as the landscape buffer along the west side within our property, and a proposed new fence along the east side adjacent to the R2 properties on the east, and an existing fence along the north side to the adjacent RMFM. And so this was our drawing from the proposed subdivision and rezoning. So just again, showing that the property will be subdivided into the two lots. So the proposed lot one is to be rezoned to RMFM from the existing agricultural, and then proposed lot two is to remain as agricultural within the PDO 1 airport vicinity. And then there were two proposed variances within this application. Proposed lot one with the multifamily residential development needed a variance for the establishment of an accessory parking area to permit parking spaces located 5 feet from the sill of a window to a habitable room from the parking instead of the 10 feet that is required. So diagram is just showing the areas in blue are 9 feet from the building to the parking stall. And then it's just these two areas here and here in red that are 5 feet from the building to the adjacent parking stalls that we require the variance for. And then the second variance is for a proposed lot two for the establishment of agricultural zoning at a lot area of 7.27 acres. Instead of the normal 40 acres. And then with this application, we had done some community consultation, but due to the pandemic, it was all virtual. So we had the information flyers seen here delivered to about 50 residents in the surrounding areas back in April. And then they were directed to visit the westlands.ca website, which then had further information about the development and conceptual plans of the buildings. And within the time that the website was live for about 2 weeks, we received no further comments or phone calls or anything from that consultation. And this was just showing the areas where we had delivered flyers to approximately. So we had some over here along Castlebury Meadows Drive, as well as along Commercial Drive. And finally, we have a diagram to show some of the conditions and clauses from Schedule B, just to show, let me just zoom in here. Okay. Yeah. To show the temporary turnaround just south of our development here. So we're just showing that we'll have a temporary cul-de-sac in order to have a turnaround at the end of this development, as well as our boulevard landscaping on the north side of Commercial Avenue and the various concrete road requirements along Commercial Avenue leading up to our development.
And then just to summarize, we have read, and Pradeep has read, and I'm sure he'll address this as well when he does his presentation, but there were no concerns with the report as written, the administrative report and the conditions that RAC had identified, and no concerns with the Schedule B. This is just an illustration of our understanding of what was included in Schedule B that was confirmed by Daniel. So again, no conditions. So this would be one of those reports where we are not asking for any changes. So we thank again the administration, Daniel Rack, very much for working with us through the process so that we could achieve this complete understanding of what was being proposed and thus have no issues with what was being proposed. But I'll leave that to Pradeep. So any questions at all?
Any questions from the committee at this point? Melissa, just on the slide regarding the community consultation, no feedback was received at all, correct?
No.
Okay. I just ask in the future that this pamphlet be shared with the department, the planning department. I do not believe they have it on file, and I do not have it on file in my office. It's always good to know when information is being disseminated out into the communities we represent. So if that could be done in the future, please.
Absolutely, and we apologize for that.
And it was 50 homes. Where exactly was this distributed?
So on this map here, we're showing in purple where the flyers were distributed to, and there may have been a couple of additional ones in the houses over here.
What streets were they?
Castlebury Meadows Drive and Commercial Avenue, just the south properties on Commercial Avenue.
And that was delivered in the mailboxes, I guess, by foot or Canada Post?
Pardeep had done the delivery, I believe it was, and he can answer that when he presents. Sorry about that, Councillor, but I do believe it was in mailboxes.
Okay, thank you. Sure. Any further questions at this point? Okay, thank you for your time. We'll move on to the next presenter.
Thank you.
Having heard from Susan and Melissa, our next person in support is Pardeep Buller. Good morning, Pardeep. You have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation, starting now. You appear to be muted, sir.
Good morning. Can you hear me now?
Yes, please go ahead.
Good morning. Thank you, councillors. Councillor Santos, Sharma, Councillor Edie, I think the presentation was very comprehensive. The questions that Councillor Sharma raised with regards to the flyer delivery, if we can put that slide back on, I'd like to just expand on that.
I don't think they can share their screen at this
time. All right, that's fine.
We have it, thank you.
Yes, we did hand deliver approximately 60 to 70 flyers. Most of the impact for this property or this project would be on the northeast corner, and those properties abutting that particular corner. There are probably about four houses that actually would have visibility to these buildings. The two houses on the south of Commercial really don't have any impact as far as this development goes. And if you're looking at the map, you'll see there's a bay that's immediately east of the property, which looks like it's been developed, but that at the time that we did the delivery, that there was no houses on that street. We are also the developers for that property, and those houses are currently under construction. All of the owners that will be occupying those houses that are immediately east of this development have already been notified and have been told about this development. So we should not expect any issues. There was no, Castleberry is a very close community. Everybody knows exactly what's going on in the neighborhood. The big billboard right now, we've built Hazelton as part of our residential development on the east side of this property. And the billboard for this hearing was also right at the corner of Hazelton and Commercial Avenue. Other than that, I think the presentation was pretty comprehensive. If there's any questions councillors have or the administration have, I'm happy to answer those.
Thank you, Pardeep. Councillor Edie, you have a question?
No, I think what's being proposed for the rezoning property, it sounds, and I can only say it sounds really, really nice. I just had only one question in regards to the property on the south side of Commercial, I think it is. So you're okay with that condition that says no development?
Yes, Councillor, we have no problem with that. Actually, just to give you a little background, this whole property is about 11 to 12 acres. And it had a restriction on it already that nothing can be developed because it didn't meet the 40-acre minimum for the agriculture, even though it was zoned agriculture. We went back and searched the bylaw, which was rescinded back in, I think it was 79 or 78. And in order for us to subdivide these two properties, this is a process we have to go through. So this is why the variance is required, because of the less than 40 acres. So there would be the current owners that own this both pieces. We will be taking possession after we are able to split this property into two pieces. We will be taking possession of the property to the north, and the current owners will maintain ownership of the property on the south. So there is no issue with having that condition, as they will be going through the process at some later time to have that rezoned. It is employment lands, so I expect that would stay as employment land, just to be, it'll be consistent with the rest of the development, rest of the property on the south side.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Just further to that, do you envision what will be happening with those ag lands into the future? Do you have a sense of what they might be looking to do?
We've had quite a bit of discussions with this, with the administrations, with RAC, and as far as discussing the buffer on the west side, particularly, and on the south side. So we expect that right, it would be consistent with what's there right now. There's a light industrial. There's really not any heavy manufacturing that's going to be next to it. There's some warehousing, light industrial, I think. And on the west side, there's a retention pond. And we expect that retention pond is going to stay forever. I understand the administration had some concern as far as, you know, the zoning for the property on the west side is M2 or M1, I think, industrial. So their concern was that can in the future somebody put up a industrial building next to these residential properties, right? But as you can see on the map, there's a retention pond there, which was constructed about 25 years ago. And in order to service that industrial land, that retention pond would remain there. So our proposal was to allow for us to present an alternative to just putting up a 6-foot high wood fence or something to block that area. We wanted to actually incorporate that into a future green space on the west side, where we envision that there would be a walkway and a view over the retention pond from this property. So that's what my thoughts are as to what's going to happen in the future.
Okay, thank you. Seeing no further questions, we'll move on to the next presenter. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
At this time, I do not have any additional registrants for support, opposition, or information.
There's no opportunity to ask questions, of course, at this time from our public service, if there's any. It's a pretty straightforward report, and I had the opportunity to meet with the applicant as well some time ago, so I'm quite familiar with this file. No other questions? Would you like to add anything, Mr. Hare? No? Okay. If we could call Susan and Melissa back.
Yes, so now's the opportunity for rebuttal, but please, no new information.
Yes, so we're just here to answer any further questions, if there are any.
Any questions? No, I think the presentation was very comprehensive. Appreciate the time of all presenters, so no further questions at this time.
Thank you.
Yes, Councillor Reedy, if you would take the chair and we can get into motion.
I will do that. Thank you, Councillor Sharma. I am the chairperson at the moment.
I'd like to move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and be forwarded to the Executive Policy Committee.
Isn't that a bit early?
Oh, I'm sorry, I've missed a
we
line
have to
here.
Close off.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd like to move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried.
I'd like to move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried.
I'd like to move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and sent off to the Executive Policy Committee via the priority rezoning process. We can do that as there was no opposition here today.
Okay. Then I'll call the question on that. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried.
My supporting reasons, Mr. Chair, we heard from our planner, this application is consistent with our Precinct T plan and what we envisioned for this area. And it's ultimately going to add new housing stock that's needed, affordable housing, I'd like to add. And as needed in the area, there's many families that are drawn to calling North Winnipeg home. And in particular, this Castlebury Meadows Waterford Green area has been growing. So I welcome this new housing stock and I thank the applicant, the developer here, Mr. Buller, for his application today. And he's done good work, very good work in the city of Winnipeg and in particular in North Winnipeg. So I'm pleased to support this application here today. And I also want to thank him for taking the time to appear before committee today, because often it's important to have the consultants here, but for the applicant, for the actual developer to come forward and speak and take the time, I know this committee appreciates that.
Absolutely. All right. Did you want to make any comment, Councillor Santos?
I think just the question. Yeah.
Yeah. She said no. All those in favor?
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried.
Thank you. I'll take the chair back.
You got to finish it off. There's a variance yet, and
that'll be the next item. I guess it's a combined hearing.
But you have to close this one off. There's, after the supporting reasons, there's is there not a?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. I think I need new glasses. Thank you. I'd like to move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried. All right, on to the variance. Unless, Mr. Prinsler, do you have to say anything after that part, the subdivision? No?
Yes. Okay. Please note that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council. No further representations are permitted on the subdivision and rezoning. All persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is to be considered by council.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. All right, Councillor Sharma.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. On the variance, I'd like to move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That's carried.
I'd like to move that the receipt of the public representations be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried.
I'd like to move that in accordance with subsection 2473 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. It does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway. It is the minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and it is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated. I already put my supporting comments on the record. The same goes here. Mr. Chair, good question.
Thank you. Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried.
I also want to take this opportunity before we move on just to thank Mr. Hare for his diligence on this application. There's a lot that goes into getting to this stage, and I appreciate him keeping me apprised. I always have lots of questions ongoing. And so thank you for your work on this file. I'd like to move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and the variance be approved.
And I ditto. This is, before I call the question, I just wanted to say as well that, like, our developers seem to be working much better with our city's administration, Mr. Hare, and the developments that are coming across at our community committee seem to be a lot less controversial than in the past. So anyway, I will call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried.
I'll move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried.
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered.
Thank you, Councillor Eady. I'll take the chair back.
Yes, may I take a quick, just a real quick break?
Yeah, 5 minute recess?
Yeah, 5 minutes.
Okay, we can just take a 5 minute recess and then we'll move on to the final item. Thank you. Great. Good morning. I'd like to reconvene our public hearing session of the Lord Selkirk West Kildonan Community Committee meeting. It's September 8th, 2021. We're on item 4 of the hearings. Mr. Clerk.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. Item 4 is a demolition at 286 Pritchard Avenue under file DEMO180867/2021 D. And for the committee's benefit, I do not have anybody registered for this item, including the applicant.
The applicant. Okay. In that case, Madam Chairperson, I will move that we adjourn this hearing to occur on October 4th at 10:30 a.m. That's October 4th, 2020.
Okay. So you're moving layover of the item. Yeah. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. That concludes our hearings for today's date. Is there any new business? Mr. Clerk, do we have the opportunity to take any new business?
If committee wanted to deal with new business, we certainly
I don't think there's any per capitas or any new business. No. Okay. In that case, Councillor Santos, will you move adjournment?
Yeah, I can move to adjourn the meeting.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Meeting's adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you.